Late one afternoon, almost 20 years ago, I was working as the senior communications manager at BASS and sitting at my desk in Montgomery, Alabama. The phone rang. I answered and a very familiar voice said, "Ken, how'd you like to have dinner with me and Radar O'Rylee from MASH?" It was BASS founder Ray Scott, and I would never turn down an opportunity to hang out with Ray or to have dinner with one of the stars of what was arguably America's most popular television show of all time. The actor who played Radar O'Rylee is Gary Burghoff, and he was the only cast member who was in both MASH the movie and a regular cast member on MASH the television series. To give you an idea of how popular MASH was back in the 1970s and early 80s, the series finale is still the most watched television broadcast in history, not counting Super Bowls. More than 100 million people watched it in 1983. That was nearly half the U.S. population at the time. Well, I met Ray and Gary at Ray's favorite Thai restaurant in Montgomery, and we had one of the most memorable meals and conversations of my life. Most of that's a story for another time. You see, although Gary Burghoff is a very serious angler with patents on several fishing products that he invented, the real reason we were there was Gary's young son, Miles. If you follow the sport of competitive bass fishing, you know about Miles Burghoff, who goes by the nickname Sonar. Get it? His dad was Radar on MASH, so Miles is Sonar. Well, 20 years ago, Miles was a teenage high school student working on a research project. He was trying to learn more about careers in bass fishing, and his dad decided to go straight to the top, to the man who created more jobs and built more careers than anyone else in the history of our sport, Ray Scott. And that's when Ray looped me in. We had a great meal, a great conversation, and I got to know the Burghoffs a little bit. Not long after, I got Miles involved making videos for us at Bassmaster.com. He was working with me and Nathan, our partner and engineer here at Bass After Dark. Nathan, Miles, and I would go out and shoot videos about youth and career opportunities in fishing, and Miles was our guy in front of the camera. Honestly, he wasn't very good at first. We thought that working with the son of an award-winning actor would be easy, but it took take after take after take sometimes to get something we could use. But we stayed with it because Miles is a great guy and a great guy to work with, and he got a lot better. In fact, today, I think he's one of the very best at videos, and he made himself that good through a lot of hard work. Miles has made his way through the ranks of the tournament world too. He's a favorite of sponsors because he gets it, and because he does a great job promoting the products of the companies he serves, including some of the very best brands in the industry. Recently, however, things have been extremely challenging for Miles and his family. His baby daughter, Rylee, was recently diagnosed with neuroblastoma, a type of cancer, and life for the Burghoffs has been turned upside down. They're currently getting her treatment through St. Jude's Research Hospital in Memphis, Tennessee. A lot of their expenses are being covered by that amazing and wonderful organization, but there are other costs that are incurred whenever you put your life and career on hold. And that's where we can help. The Burghoff family has established a GoFundMe campaign. In addition, you can follow Miles and his family's journey on his YouTube channel and his website. You can also support them by purchasing Sonar merchandise. We'll put links to all that below and in this description below the video on YouTube here. And if you're wondering why the son of a Hollywood star might need financial help, know that Miles's dad, Gary Burghoff, was a star in the days before television actors got big residual deals. So although MASH had been in syndication for nearly 40 years, Gary didn't get a dime of the millions of dollars spent or made to keep it on television all this time. And Miles is not some spoiled trust fund kid. So please help if you're able. I want to close this monologue on an upbeat note. I want to tell you one more thing about the evening I met Miles and his dad and had dinner with them and Ray Scott almost 20 years ago. It was a moment I'll never forget. As at the end of dinner, we're leaving the restaurant and Gary Burghoff put his arm around me and he looked at me and he said, "You know, Ken, Yul Brynner was a friend of mine. And he didn't become a star until he started shaving his head and wearing all black. Think about it." Well, Gary, I've been shaving my head for a long, long time now. And although I don't often wear all black, I am wearing a purple smoking jacket. Hopefully that'll help. Welcome to Bass After Dark. I'm Ken Duke, and we want to earn your support, your subscription, your like, and your share by showing you that inch for inch and pound for pound, we are the most illuminating show in all of bass fishing. Now it's time to bring on my co-host. He's recovering from shoulder surgery. I got it right this time. But he's tough as nails because he drives them all day long. Please welcome Brian the Carpenter.
Thank you, Ken.
Absolutely my pleasure, partner.
Beautiful, beautiful intro and monologue. Miles is one of them guys. He stands out to me. He is the first person that came up to me. I think I was at the airport flying home from a classic or maybe an ICAST. The very, very beginning, first like year of Ike Live. And Miles came up, introduced himself to me and told me, you know, he really likes what we're doing and it appreciates it. And being at Ike Live was kind of the first thing, like really getting edgy and talking about things. He's like, it's necessary. You know, you guys get a little, you know, but the industry needs it. And then he handed me his card. And, you know, you talked about it, like nobody more professional and better to work with than Miles in the industry.
I believe it was hard to believe that I met Miles. I think it was 20 years ago in November or December. And yeah, he's come so far and he is the consummate professional and just a really wonderful person. And I hate that his family is going through such a tough time right now.
Yeah. Same here. You know, I wish I had one of his shirts to be wearing tonight, but I will by next week. Mark my words.
There you go.
And another thing about Miles, we had him, we interviewed him with Bass University at an ICAST, and he is the very first person that I'm aware of, that we were aware of, that was using all the brands of electronics in the early days. He wasn't taking a sponsorship from Hummingbird, Lowrance, Garmin. He was using them all, and he kind of opened our eyes to it. He was the first one that I know. Before Wheeler, I'm pretty sure.
He's a real student of the game. That's one of the things I always appreciated about Miles is he's a true student of the game, and not every bass pro is. He works hard to stay on top of the technology and all of those things, but he also understands the people who came before him in the sport. But let's change gears a little bit, BTC. You know, last week we introduced a new concept to the show we call Bad Comments. Mm-hmm. And you got to meet our intern, Jacob Morrison. And we said, hey, we're going to read all the funny, mean comments that y'all post on the show through YouTube. But we don't want to make it just about the mean, bad comments. If you have a question for me or for BTC or for Nathan or for Jacob, that's a good place to post it as well. Not so much for our show guests, because by the time we get back to bad comments, that part of the show is over. But if you got a question for us, we'd love to hear it.
Yes, and it's also a good time to offer up your suggestions for Jacob's nickname. So
Jacob's
nickname. You got to see more of them. You got to kind of get a feel for the personality, and then lay it on them.
Other show topics you'd like to see us do? Keep in mind that all our show topics are in the form of a question. But if you got show topics you want to see us do, by all means, let us know there. Criticisms, let us have it. We can handle it. We're big boys. Got a great top 10 tonight, BTC.
Yes, we do. Top 10 beings that were on the heels of corporate card sales day yesterday. We have top 10 angler pickup lines. Is that what it is?
Yeah, top 10 tackle shop pickup lines.
Tackle shop.
So if anybody in our audience is looking for love in a tackle shop, we got game.
That's right.
And a great question tonight. I'm excited about this question. This one's been on our list for, well, since before we ever started Bass After Dark. And the question is, has catch and release gone too far? And Brian, I know that you worry a little bit that people may not understand exactly where we're going with that.
Yeah. I would say it's so much worry as it is an observation. And it's a tough one to promote. I'll figure it out after the fact how we should have gone. But it's a very important and valid topic and conversation to have that's not on anybody's minds. And it's just, we've all just kind of been going past it. As a matter of fact, it was 52 years ago, January, February, 1972, when Ray Scott had his first catch and release tournaments and really unveiled catch and release on the world 52 years ago, like today, pretty much. And as time went on, it just got more and more entrenched. I know I'm a big believer in it. I know I get, I feel certain kind of ways when I see fish, you know, freaking glazed eyes and, you know, in anglers photos, whether at the scales or people flying them, we really have gotten attached to them, and that's a good thing. There's also another angle. There's also another way to look at this. And I never really had thought about it. You know, I kind of caught wind of it from some biologists I follow, and that is how much that may be stunting the potentials for trophy fish. There's a whole formula they have to go into about it with. It's a good conversation, and I don't think we won't end this show with one definitive answer.
What?
Everybody in the water. Well, because we.
Where's your faith? Where's your faith?
Exactly. Yeah. Well, you know, I ain't got a lot right now, but every body of water is different. Every body of water requires a different plan. But this is a good place to start.
Speaking of good place to start, let's bring our panelists in.
Oh, here we go. All right. This is a beauty.
This is an all-star panel, folks.
I know. We get like angels singing or something while I do this.
We have the best guests in bass fishing, yeah. By the way.
Indeed.
So everybody knows.
One of bass fishing's all-time greats, 1987 Bassmaster Angler of the Year, 1996. 98. Eyes are terrible. 1998 Bassmaster Classic Champion, 18-time BASS Tournament Winner, 21-time Bassmaster Classic Qualifier, 1996 FLW Angler of the Year, first professional angler.
Sorry. Gotta get the too vain to wear glasses is a problem. Too vain.
Yes, it is. It is. First professional angler ever to appear on a Wheaties box. Multiple guest appearances on Late Show with David Letterman. By the way, guys, this is how big the font is. It's like ridiculous. Huge. And I struggle to see it because of the lighting. The great, the one and only Denny Brauer.
Denny, thank you so much for joining us, man. BTC got a couple of years screwed up there because he's too vain to wear eyeglasses.
I'm on painkillers, Denny.
I have these glasses right here.
Me neither.
You know, 98, when Denny won the Classic and FLW Angler of the Year and was on the Wheaties box and is on David Letterman, my argument is that is the finest season anybody's ever put together in professional bass fishing.
Well, I appreciate that, Ken. But before we get started, I just want to wish all my best to Miles and his family. That was a great tribute you did right there. And hopefully everything comes out working great.
They got some good news today. They found out that there's apparently a genetic marker that people have if this kind of cancer is going to get worse and take them to a more elevated standard of danger. And she doesn't have it. So they're at an intermediate level, and that's some good news today.
Awesome. Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Well,
that's fantastic news.
Well, Denny, thank you so much for being here. We really appreciate you, man. BTC, we got more guests.
Yes, we do. We have a bachelor's degree in freshwater biology. We got out of the science from Tarleton State University. I'm going to continue to forever call it that, by the way.
It's a Texas school. Let's call it Tarleton.
It's Tarleton's. Master's degree in fishery science from Texas A&M, fisheries biologist for MLF, owner of Texas Pro Lake Management, and his second time on Bass After Dark, we have Steve Bardin. Steve Bardin.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for having me. Definitely love the tribute to Miles and his family. Just joined onto the social media and saw that, and it's heartbreaking. So thank you all for putting that forward first before we get into trying to convince BTC that not every bass deserves to live.
You're also going to have to convince Denny, I think. But
no,
we'll
Denny,
be there in a moment.
Denny's a hunter. He's a fisherman. He's going to get it. He's going to get it.
Okay. All right. I love the confidence. We got another guest, though, another expert panelist. BTC, can you bring him on for us?
Indeed we do. Another fisheries biologist stacking the deck against us tree huggers and hippies, long-haired hippies like me and Denny. recently retired as regional fisheries supervisor of the Georgia DNR. Now a full-time guide in the Okefenokee Swamp of Southeast Georgia Fisheries, has made custom lures commercially since high school and still does. Website for his guiding and fishing lures is Bert's Jigs and Things. We've got Captain Bert Deener.
Good evening.
Welcome, Bert, and thank you for being with us. For anybody who doesn't know Bert, Bert may be the most passionate angler I know. I've been on multiple junkets and trips with Bert, and you know, maybe you come in for lunch or dinner. Bert is the guy out on the dock when everybody else is trying to eat. Bert's got a sandwich in his hand and he's throwing an ultralight for panfish. He's a maniac.
Doesn't matter what I'm catching, I enjoy catching them.
Well,
that entry can does put everything in perspective. Absolutely, praying for Miles and his family.
Yeah, it does. Unfortunately, yep. It's sad news, but reason for optimism, especially today. So that's good stuff.
Absolutely.
Well, guys, just to set the stage a little bit, you know, catch and release was a trout thing before it was ever a bass thing. And we want to give a lot of credit to Ray Scott for starting catch and release in the bass world back in the late 60s, early 70s. Ray went to some outdoor writer event, saw a lot of guys catching trout. And when they would release one, everybody would stand around and applaud, and this tiny little trout was being released. And Ray thought, well, man, I can take this to the world of bass. It'll really make a difference. And he introduced the concept, like BTC was telling us a little bit ago, in the January, February 1972 issue of Bassmaster magazine. And BASS's first catch and release tournament was in March 72 on the Kissimmee chain near where I live. But a week before that, an organization called the Bass Casters Association actually had what was the very first catch and release tournament. They beat BASS by 6 days. But hardly matters. I think Ray deserves a lot of credit for what he did, and catch and release took on ever since then. And Denny Brauer, I want to start with you, because years ago, you made a statement to me that I thought was both funny and just very poignant. You said that eating a bass would be like eating your retirement plan. I just loved that line, and I wonder if you still feel that way now that you are retired from the tour.
Well, Ken, I ate a lot of bass growing up. There's no doubt about it. I first started fishing, and they are pretty good eating. But as I got older and realized the value of them and how important of a fish they are from a recreational standpoint, the value of catch and release is just unbelievable. A lot of these lakes, and I'm no fishery biologist, and of course, living in Texas, we're pretty spoiled. All our fisheries managers have done a tremendous job. We've got great fishing. But everybody in water is different, without a doubt. They need to be managed different. And I truly believe that on some lakes at some times, there should not be any bass allowed to be taken out. So I think there's a big difference there. I understand pond management. So much of it has to do with the food available. It's no different than how many cows you can graze on 80 acres of land. You know, you've got to take a lot of different things into consideration. And your other two guests are a lot better at figuring that stuff out than I am. But man, it just kills me when I see somebody chop the head off a 10 pounder. I want to really get in a fight.
Well, yes.
Well, you know, our other guests have the background and the biology degrees, but Denny Brauer, I put you up against anybody in understanding the resource. And your son's a fisheries biologist too. And I know you've had a lot of discussions with Chad through the years about stuff like this, but that comment you made always stuck with me. BTC, I know you got a question for Bert.
Yes. And Denny, thank you for ending that the way you did with chopping a head off a 10 pounder and wanting to beat they ass. Cause I agree, bud. It definitely gets emotional. Bert, when's the last time you ate a bass?
Ah.
When's the last time what?
You ate a bass.
Probably 2 or 3 weeks ago.
There you go.
I still keep them. The thing is, I don't. The direct answer to the question about the has catch and release gone too far, my answer would be maybe. Because just like Denny was saying, every system's different. Every system needs something different. And what I've been preaching for the last decade is selective harvest. And to answer your question, when was the last time I ate a 5 pound bass or bigger? I don't remember. But the last time I ate a 12, 13 inch bass was just a few weeks ago. They're pretty good. I still
good
eat those.
You,
and see, my perspective is a little bit different because in Southeast Georgia, we don't have the huge reservoirs where you're talking millions of fish. We manage mostly 200 to 500 to 600 acre lakes. So that's a big difference than managing a Lake Lanier or any of the big reservoirs. So it's a little bit different. And in those small systems, it helps the system to take out some of those small ones. There's certain systems where it actually helps to take some of the smaller ones out.
Yeah, Bert, I'm glad you're we definitely picked the right guy tonight because I felt like I was going to be alone in this. And I know Georgia's got a big electric-only fishing community. I didn't know just how big, but that's very similar to what New Jersey's like. Everything's, you know, 50 to, you know, 500 acre lakes, you know, a lot of 50, 75, 150, 200 acre lakes. So I'm looking forward to getting into it a little bit deeper with you later on,
sure,
on that. All right, Steve, how many bass do you kill a year?
That's an excellent question, Ryan. And
yeah,
I'm privileged
by myself.
Yeah. I'm privileged to wear two hats. One where I own a private lake management company. And just like Denny said, whenever you start managing ponds and small impoundments, we manage everything from quarter acre up to 1,000 acre reservoirs. Whenever you're managing those, you do have to remove a lot of bass. And between me and my staff, we do harvest tens of thousands of fish a year, largemouth. And then I wear this other hat where I work for Major League Fishing, and I get to represent what I would consider the league that has the most conservation friendly with the catch, weigh, and immediate release format, and really promoting catch and release to another level beyond what traditional bass tournaments does. So I get to do both of those things and can live in a silo where catch and release is really important. And at the same time, understanding that to manage a fishery properly, regardless of size, some harvest has to take place.
That's great stuff. And we realized going into this question that this is a very nuanced question. And we just wanted to get the perspective of three experts on it. And Denny, One of the reasons you're such a great guy to bring into this conversation is because you're also a very avid and very skilled hunter. And so you understand very well the game management elements of hunting. When you think about fishing, have you thought about it always in the same way you think about hunting as a management thing about the harvest and things like that? Or did you always treat them as radically different management concepts?
Well, they're a little bit the same, Ken, except it depends on whether you got parameters or not. If you look at a group of deer in a high fence area, you've got a carrying capacity of food for so many deer. You get any more than that, you're going to have to start harvesting or they're going to all starve to death. The same thing happens in a lot of these communities where the deer stockpile or they don't allow hunting. They end up, eating all the bushes. You can see the browse line gets real high. The deer end up diseasing out, and you end up harming the deer. So they do need to be managed, just like fisheries need to be managed. But you really got to look at every fishery individual, as the guys have said. I've got friends that got 30-acre ponds on their ranches, and if you just let it go and don't take some of them littler bass out, you're going to end up with nothing but little bass that are stunning. So you really got to ask yourself, do you want big bass? Do you want big deer? Do you want little deer? Do you want little bass? There's different ways to manage. You want a lot of bites or you want a few big bites? I look back on my days at Lake of the Ozarks. One of the fishery biologists up there, he says, we've got to get rid of the Kentucky bass in this lake because, you know, there's only so much forage. And would you rather have 10 5-pound bass per acre of water or would you rather have 51-pound Kentuckys? So they took the size limit away on the Kentuckys, hoping the crappie fishermen would start keeping them. So there's just endless examples.
That is, I love that you brought up that point. And Bert, I think that everybody comes from a very different perspective here. And Bert is a longtime guy working with the state, a biologist with the state. I tend to think of the state most often managing for numbers because most anglers want to get out there and catch as many fish as they can. They're less focused on size, whereas Steven in the private management aspect of it, he may be more managing for size. Is that a fair statement with regard to the difference between public management and private management? And B, I think we look at deer and stuff like that, and they're very easy to spot, even though we all know they hide. We don't really have a great idea of their population numbers. But because fish are underwater, we don't see them. It seems like it's so much more difficult to manage them. There's ahead, a question Steve. In there somewhere, Bert.
You're correct about the approach from the state. I mean, we generally get a feel for, you always start with what do you want? I mean, what's the objective before you figure out how you're going to manage, what the regulations will be, what kind of forage enhancements or habitat enhancements. You always go into it that way, but it's more for good fishing. Whereas I let Steve talk, but on the small, and we do manage small systems, our public fishing areas, we have trophy lakes. So we manage them very differently with what we do based on what we want. So you always go back to that initial question of what are you trying for on that system?
Steven, can you talk a little bit about what most of your private clients are looking for in management?
I will, and then I want to ask Bert a very pointed question.
Bert,
get ready.
I'll put him on first. Just like Denny described carrying capacity, you have a carrying capacity in your fishery. Your carrying capacity is determined by your climate, your water quality, how many optimal growing days do you have versus how many stress days do you have, how much forage is available, and then how much competition is there for that forage. And you can create a formula and you can calculate, you can't get it perfect, but you can calculate your carrying capacity. And then you have to look at fish, and there's no age determined growth on fish. So then you have to age how old are fish at each size class and decide, do I have the resources to move those fish to the next size class? And you put in some sort of harvest regulation in private ponds. It may be very aggressive. Like you're pulling out 25% of the fish a year. to try to move things forward and stabilize that food chain. But I think the same thing is reflected in a public reservoir. The question I have is, are regulations working? If we look at what are the goals, and that's kind of my question to Bert, like if you look across the states, and I go to every AFS meeting just like you do, you look across the states, how many conversations are we having about angler participation in regulation? And is the regulation actually producing the outcome that we're looking for?
Well, you know, that's a great point with slot limits. That was the hot thing in the 90s when we're kind of realizing the different relationships of growth and numbers and forage availability. This was kind of before spotted bass entered the picture and messed it all up. But that they really didn't work. In most situations, people wouldn't keep those small fish. And the catch and release ethic had gotten so strong. We had a reservoir here in Georgia that the same thing. We tried slot limits a couple places, and it ended up being, just say the slot was 13 to 16, it ended up being a 16 inch minimum because people would not keep those smaller slot fish. So in that regard, no, that didn't work. So it depends on what the regulation is and what the objective is. The regulation, a lot of times we go, there's two ways to go. There's the optimal management where you do some kind of a slot limit or some kind of different regulation. And then there's simplicity so that when someone goes fishing in a certain state, they know that's what the limit is. It's simple. And the simple regulation always captures and allows that fish to spawn. It allows them to grow big enough that they're going to get off a spawn. That's kind of the thought process behind that. But it's when you get into that complex stuff, a lot of times it doesn't work if people don't understand the regulation or they don't obey the regulation. That's where it falls apart. But that slot limit was a great idea. If people would have done it, if people would have kept those small fish so there's fewer mouths to feed, the growth rate improves, then it would have worked. But in most cases, slot limits do not work.
Steve, can you cite any examples of lakes where they should not, where catch and release should be strictly upheld and no culling of fish?
Yeah, I mean, you could, especially whenever we start talking about smallmouth. There's certain times of the year where smallmouth need to be protected because they're notorious for nest abandonment. Especially if we're just talking about tournament fishing, even putting them in the live well and transporting them is difficult. So there are specific lakes where it's really important, especially I'm trying to think of examples where we have bad year classes like Kentucky Lake, for example, whenever Asian carp started to increase in density, we had low recruitment. And so harvest became very important because if you pull fish out and you have low recruitment, you don't have the adults available. I think the biggest issue, Brian, is we are bass fishermen and fish tournaments and want to catch advanced size fish, trophy size fish. And our harvest regulations are just like what Bert described. They're allowing you to grow fish to a size that they're mature and they can reproduce and then harvest them. And in a lot of cases, as bass anglers, we have to then decide at what point from harvestable to advanced size, like where should we then start protecting them ourselves? Just like Bert said, when was the last time you ate a 5-pound fish? Never. And with Denny, if somebody has a 10-pound fish and they're harvesting that fish, they should be punched. Like that's
they should. Can we all agree?
Those fish are rare. But there's a window in there, just like Bert described, where we need harvest. And truthfully, if you look at a lot of states, Florida, Oklahoma, I've got a great image, Nathan, of what Oklahoma is doing and Florida is doing right now, where they're looking at annual catch rates of fish and their overall sizes are declining and they're reversing their harvest regulations. And they're now allowing for more fish to be harvested below 16 inches because it's going to drive. There it is. This is the Oklahoma reg. I've got a couple cool charts for us to look at tonight. But what you're seeing is if you put a regulation where you can't harvest fish before they're 16 inches, the fish aren't growing to that size. They're stunting below that size. So what Oklahoma and Florida are now doing is allowing you to harvest five fish below or six fish below 16 inches or five fish below 16 and one over 16. And this is what your new harvest regulations are going to start looking like across the country, because we're unfortunately the lack of participation in the regulations in like Bert described, how we have to simplify regulations so we can get compliance. It's leading to too many fish below that legal harvestable size.
I gotcha.
Denny, you might want to punch me because I once chopped the head off a 12 pounder.
Question I got, can or size limits and regulation more important, or is the carrying capacity of the lake? In other words, you look at any new lake, fishing is excellent. It's got a lot of 4-H in it. And why is that? It's got a lot of habitat, a lot of cover. So is that the whole secret to having a good fishery? You get to some of these lakes as they get older, they don't have any cover. They don't have that carrying capacity. They can't support near the bait fish or the bass. You look at the lakes that got the hydrilla, usually they're better fishing. It goes on example-wise. So, you know, do we need to look at it more from a habitat standpoint and regulation as far as water levels, or do we look at it from size limit restrictions?
Science guys?
Yeah, science guys. You've just been questioned.
Can I say both, Denny? You need all of that. And I think Bert's about to tell you the same thing. All of our reservoirs across the entire United States are aging at a rapid rate. The process of aging means they're accumulating silt, habitats degrading or being buried. They're increasing in nutrient, which actually reduces productivity. You have an abundance of what we would call not necessarily exotic, but invasive plants because there's more habitat available for them. That drives your carrying capacity down. So we have to address water level fluctuations. We really need to build some sort of silt mitigation plan and remediation plan. We have to do habitat. Those things have to happen to give you the reservoir that you had in the past that still has that carrying capacity. But if we ignore harvest and we allow fish to grow in number unchecked in an unproductive environment, we're kind of shooting ourselves in the foot.
Now, Bert, before you jump in here, there's something I've always called the spotification of America, where as the, like Denny was talking about, as these reservoirs age, they become clearer, less fertile. It seems like spotted bass take over. And I watched it happen in North Georgia when I lived there more than 20 years ago. And I know it's happened in other parts of the country too. Is that due to lower fertility, clearer waters? And when these spots come in, are they adequately taking over for the loss of largemouth bass that we're experiencing, or are they not filling in the same biomass?
And are they more likely to vote Republican or Democrat? Go ahead.
Well, I'm worried that Steven just pointed out that smallmouth are more likely to abandon their nest. I will not call the smallmouth's morality into question here, but Steven Bardin just did. I'm sorry, Bert. There was a question there for Bert somewhere.
Well, on the reservoir end of things, that each biologist, it's everything there, Denny. It's all of that is taken into effect. And there's a long history. I can't speak for other states, but in Georgia, the biologists monitor every lake, every population, lots, thousands of fish a year. And there's all kinds of metrics that we use without even killing the fish. And sometimes we do kill the fish to get the otolith, to age the ear bone, where then we can age it like tree rings. And you can actually track growth. We do that especially on our small systems, to check to make sure the growth is continuing, making sure and comparing it from year to year, decade to decade. So on most systems, we can track that, and we have discussions over that as far as management and get public input along the way as well. So it's the systems that, like like the smaller private systems are actually the ones that aren't tracked as well as the big reservoirs that have assigned biologists, and annually, sometimes twice a year, we'll sample the different fisheries, and there are different calculations. Steven talked about one of the calculations. We do other calculations to determine about stripers, and that's probably a hot button topic on a bass show, but determine how many stripers to stock and how many you can support. Thank you, Ken. but there's all kinds of parameters there and things that we monitor. That wasn't part of my job. I didn't actually work on the big reservoirs, but that is what happens. And so they monitor that over the decades, Denny, on the eutrophication or the getting clearer. It's more toward the spotted bass, and that's an exotic species. So when it comes in, they usually explode. And if the habitat's right, they explode. And that's a bad thing.
I know that's a big topic in the Carolinas and such, and you know, I've seen where they're like, you know, a Hartwell, like, eat all the spots, you know. What can be done to I mean, is there anything as the anglers that we should be doing? Obviously you're not supposed to do anything without directive from the state. Well, you know. Like, what's going on in the Carolinas? Are they addressing that?
Well,
yeah, they're in North Carolina specifically, like Lake Norman. You have two things going on at one time. They've liberalized the limit on Alabama bass to where you can harvest as many as you'd like at any size. They're also doing some restocking programs. Where they're introducing F1 largemouth to try to make up for the recruitment loss, which, you know, truthfully, without adequate habitat, stocking fish doesn't work. That's an uphill battle. You know, stocking fish is rarely the answer to any question, but it could be part of this equation to try to overcome Alabama bass specifically. I think whenever you ask the question of what could anglers do, the first thing I say is learn who your biologist is or what district your reservoir falls in, and then pay attention to when regulation changes come up, because there's going to be a public comment section where you can participate as an angler, and you can say, I, BTC, want to harvest 200 Alabama bass a day, and they will take what you have to say into account. And usually, Bert, you can probably attest to this, when those kind of regulation phases come up where for public comment, very few people participate. A shockingly small number of people participate.
Unless it's something real controversial, that's correct.
Absolutely. And then the other thing, I think as an angler, you should become aware of what Friends of Reservoirs is. It's a nonprofit to where your bass club could sign up. You could be a chapter. You could then get work with biologists, get federal grant money to make improvements to your local fishery. And it's usually habitat related, because truthfully, that's the area that you as an angler can impact the fishery most positive. But that would start building that relationship with your local biologist. And that communication between angler and biologist is so important.
Absolutely.
Is that a real number? 200, culling 200 bass a day, or?
Keeping 200 bass a day.
What are you keeping?
It's not really. No.
I was just saying, I didn't catch 200 bass last year. That's ridiculous. And one more thing. Again, I think I brutalized that last question. Just keep in mind, I'm on painkillers over here. So bear with me, folks. Well,
let me ask, I'm not a biologist. I'm not one of the greatest anglers of all time.
So you are to me, Ken.
Yeah, well, okay. That means I don't fit in with this expert group of panelists. But obviously, Bert, when the state sets creel limits, they're hoping that a certain percentage of the population will keep some of those fish, eat some of those fish. But if every angler did it, then they'd have to reset the creel limits because it would be too much harvest. And in every state, and in even regions of the states, there are different creel limits. As anglers, is there an optimal level of harvest and consumption that we should consider or try to live by to help the state in managing this resource? Or is that just too random a question?
No, that's not too random at all. I mean, for the different systems, if you follow the regulations, and like we were talking about last time I ate a 5-pound bass, I mean, that's kind of the approach. It's really easy to replace that 12 to 13 inch fish. Most systems you're going to replace, at least down here in South Georgia, you replace that fish in a year. Whereas the bigger fish, it takes years, sometimes 5, 6, 8 years to replace that fish. And you're helping by keeping the smaller. It's almost always the biggest across the country thing that I could say is if you keep the smaller fish in that range, that's going to help the system, because almost all systems need some level of harvest. Steve, would you agree with that?
Yeah, absolutely, Bert. I think Ken, the hard part is every year your agency is going to do krill surveys, and they're going to understand what angler demographics are. So they're going to know how to set a regulation and react to what angler opinion is, how many fish they're catching, you know, per outing, how many fish they're harvesting per outing. So the regulations you're seeing are becoming to where you can harvest more fish because it's not being done at the rate that it used to. Mm-hmm. If we look, you're going to get to a point in a second, but hold on, Ken. if we look at the history of harvest regulations, there weren't any in the 60s. They started playing with them 70s, 80s. And if you read about those harvest regs, the concern was that people would still continue to harvest fish outside of the reg. And as we've changed from the 90s and into the 2000s and now today, the papers are the opposite. They're saying that people aren't participating in the harvest reg, so we're not getting the harvest we need. So the culture has become so strong that we have to release every single fish. It's gone too far to almost make that part of the biologist toolbox useless, because if you don't have participation, it doesn't happen. Now we rely more on what's incidental harvest of fish due to angler mortality or tournament mortality. That's where it's coming from. And that's number one, it's not enough, but number two, it's aimed at the wrong size class of fish.
And I want to dive into that topic deeper. back up a quick second. I think a lot of what you're talking about with people not eating fish today, there's also a lot of available food compared to, you know, like you can get a fillet of fish and people are lazy. So I think that's also part of the equation. People don't want to cook it, but here's something I'm curious about. When you talk about, you know, eating the smaller fish, pulling them out of the system, is there a way to tell if that 12 to 14, 15 inch fish is, you know, that could be a fish with very strong genetics that's 2 years old versus, you know, that's a runt that's 4 years old on a particular body of water? Is there a way to, you know, to easily identify things like that and know that these are the fish to pull out?
Not scientists? Easily, but if you looked at a bunch of fish, you can tell that eye grows at basically the same rate. So if that fish has got a little tiny beady eye and he's a big fish, you know that's a young one just in general. Or if it's got a big head for the shape of the body, and a big eye for the size of the body, a lot of times you'll know, hey, that's a pretty old fish. Call that one out. And I'm not saying 6-pound. I have actually had one system where the guy wanted trophy fish. It was Pat Cullen, who's caught a ton of 10-pound bass. And he had a system that was, I had never seen anything like it. He really needed to cull 5 and 6-pound fish out of that particular system to continue the growth, to push those fish up. And that's the only one that I've seen that way. So, I mean, Pat Cullen.
Where's he live?
He passed away about a decade ago.
God,
yeah, Cullen was in Valdosta.
2014. And Bert made Pat Cullen's buzz baits. Pat Cullen was a renowned nighttime buzz bait guy who caught well over 1,000 10-pounders.
Well, it was that system's still doing its thing?
That's none of your business. Bert and I are fishing there next week.
Well, I don't have permission to fish there.
Well, we're going to work on that.
My point is that that's not a typical system. Most systems, that growth starts plateauing at 4 or 5 pounds, and you start getting these fish with big eyes, and they're not real healthy. They're not growing well. I mean, that's where you want to cull out those smaller fish. And I mean, as a general statement across the country, really, that's a fairly accurate statement to keep fish in the smaller size range, and you're going to help the growth. You're adding groceries to the other fish that are there. So that's kind of the selective harvest.
Denny, if we're not harvesting enough of these smaller fish, and I know you're a big fish guy, it's one of the reasons you moved to Amistad, and I know you fish some private water too, where you catch giant fish. What would it take for a superior and highly successful angler like a Denny Brauer? What kind of incentive do you have before you would want to participate in some of this harvest? Is there anything that could make you go there or not?
Absolutely. If there's not enough forage for the fish to eat, they're going to be skinny and they need to be taken out. I think it's the easiest formula in the world. You go to a body of water, mm-hmm. whether it's a small pond or a lake, and you catch fish and they're unhealthy, they're skinny. There's fish that need to be taken out. If they're all fat and sassy, that fishery's in good shape. You could have so many fish per acre if you had the amount of forage there to feed them. It's all about the groceries, in my opinion, and I may be totally wrong. I'm sure there's a lot of other factors, but to me, one thing that does not get addressed on a lot of these lakes is how strong the forage base is. I think we got a problem right now on Amistad that we do not have enough shad in the lake, and I think you get more shad there, and there's conditions that change that. If we could get some water in the lake, get it up into the cover, we'd get a better recruitment of bait, too, so there's a lot of variables there, but man, if you got groceries, you've got good bass.
Steven, we talked about the regulations and how they're changing, and I am starting to see some of the creel limits and things like that change, but it seems like they were stagnant for so long. But my question is different. You talked about how there were not a lot of creel limits and stuff like that decades ago, and of course you're right. But decades ago, let's go back just to the early 70s. Quite often the creel limit on the various black bass species would be 15 when people were actually keeping every fish they caught. Now, when they're not keeping every fish they caught, the creel limits are 5 and 6. Mm-hmm. That seems very counterintuitive to me.
Yep. And participation is lower today. So you have less anglers. They're more skilled though. I think the truth is, Ken, reservoir management started in the 60s. So you have fisheries biologists that in the 70s, they're only 10 years into their career. They're only 10 years into understanding where these fisheries, because reservoirs are artificial systems. So could it be possible that they were learning as the reservoirs were aging? And the reservoirs were producing fish at a much faster rate because of the new reservoir effect. Just like Denny described, forage was more abundant, habitat was more abundant, the fishery's more productive. It probably was more elastic and could handle that greater harvest. Your challenge now is that you're still talking about that same reservoir. The science has evolved. We understand it a little better. But now we have a population of anglers that don't participate. We don't have a consumptive population as much now.
But don't we also have a factor now, a lot more angler pressure, and there's going to be a lot of fish kill happen because of the fish being overhandled, overcaught, et cetera. We also have a factor with some of the 4-H fish. I know down on Falcon, we had an issue with a big gar, alligator gar. They were eating 6-7 pound bass. They did stomach samples, cut them open. So, I mean, there's a lot of factors that make bass disappear without eating them.
Well, yeah, let's separate them and dive into how tournament pressure affects and plays into all this first.
Yeah. Well, to Denny's point, you have a percentage of the population of every size class of bass that has a mortality every year. And your total mortality per size class could be 50% of that population every year for all those reasons that you just described. whenever we talk about tournaments, just like the regulations have evolved over time, tournament and the systems of live wells and the way the fish have been handled and now are using release boats, and now there's the catchway and immediate release system, that's evolving as well. So we have reservoirs that are aging, but we have more educated anglers, but our license sales are down. So we have less anglers overall. Anglers that participate at a higher level, but they have better technology. So we do have fish that are being transported, but the mortality of those fish, at least direct mortality, is very low. Whenever you have a fishing tournament, a large tournament, Denny, you know, you're like 1%, 2% of the fish that are weighed in that you know, aren't live fish. The delayed mortality is very difficult to study, and it can range depending on the time of year and the number of anglers and so many factors. And it could be low. It could be in the 10%. It could be high. It could be 50%. And that is something that we should become more aware of, especially as we continue to increase the number of high school and college anglers. And a lot of them do like fundraising tournaments and things like that, where they don't have the resources that a large event may. We have to be more aware of the fact that stresses the top end of the system. It really focuses on those advanced size fish, and we have to continue to work on advancing fish care for tournaments. That doesn't have to play into harvest. Those can be two separate conversations.
Steven, you talk about the numbers of license sales, and mm-hmm. It sounds like your numbers are a little different than what I'm hearing and understand. I thought the number of license sales in the U.S. peaked around 2019, 2020 during COVID. We had about 54 million anglers at that point. That was the first time license sales had gone back to where they were in about 1991. And perhaps the bigger problem is every time the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service does that study, the number of anglers, the percentage of anglers who identify as bass anglers drops. 50 years ago, that number was 16-17%. Today, it's around 10%.
Right.
But I would maintain that the people who are chasing bass now are probably a lot more proficient. One problem I see is, of course, we're not building new reservoirs. And that's probably hurting the number of anglers we're bringing into the sport. But let me ask you a weird biological question here, because Ooh. You're in Texas. Yeah. Bert is in Georgia. And both you guys are in states with very diverse fisheries, especially Georgia, where you have basically every member of the black bass species except the Guadalupe somewhere in that state. Does that make management, Bert, more demanding, more difficult, because you've got so many different species to manage? Biologists who may be an expert in largemouth but maybe not so proficient in spots, is that a challenge?
Absolutely, but it's kind of regionally based. So unless you have a lot of movement around, I mean, the biologist that's in this certain area is going to be dealing with those species. I mean, I don't have to deal with many of the red-eye bass in my region because I'm in southeast Georgia. So it's not like you got to know all 10 species and the habitats and what you have to do for them. But there's common links such as exotic species. That's what I'm seeing as a real major. I'm leaving the profession right now, but that was one of the big things this last decade. It's the spotted bass and just other fish ending up where they're not supposed to be, forage end of things as well. So that's another thing, Denny, you alluded to carrying capacity. That messes it all up when you throw exotic species in there and people moving different critters around, and that has an effect on all of it. But I mean, each biologist doesn't have to know all 10 species, but it is a real diverse state here in Georgia.
Denny, you're a guy from Nebraska, spent many, many years in Missouri. Now you've been in Texas for quite a while. You've seen a lot of different fish management styles and certainly dealt with a lot of different biologists. You've also seen through the decades, as I have, different management practices and so forth. I've seen a lot of contradictory advice coming from biologists through the years as well. Has that been your experience?
Well, I think every body of water in every state's a little bit different on what they've got to offer and what they have to work with. So you got to manage accordingly. Mm-hmm. But you look at the lakes up north, like when I was in Nebraska, there were several months of the year the lakes were froze over back then when I was growing up. So unless you ice fished, those fish were not getting any pressure at all. There was no fish being taken out of the lake. So the carrying capacity for those lakes was a lot easier probably to manage than, an area like Florida or even Texas where everybody fishes year round.
Yeah, we're lucky here in Florida, guys. It was almost 80 today. Steven, what is the biggest challenge that you face as a fisheries biologist in managing a particular body of water?
Well, that's great. So when we're talking private bodies of water, we do get this harvest question. Almost every single lake that I put my electrofishing boat into is under harvested. And I got Nathan to have two charts that we use every single day. And I want to show everybody how we kind of set that harvest regulation based on the amount of fish we're catching, what size classes they are, and what their relative weight is. Nathan, can you pull it up?
Nathan's pulling that up real quick. Antifa leader Terry Battisti on the message board said that Ray Scott started catch and release, therefore this is all his fault.
No, Ray Scott actually announced it first, but the Bass Casters Association had the first catch and release tournament, Terry Battisti.
Leader of the Antifa.
Don't say that.
What?
All right, I'm taking the show back.
sorry, go ahead.
I'm taking it back. So whenever you talk reservoir management or pond management, the first thing you're going to do is you're going to get length classes on all the fish. So this is your standard. I'm going to go out. It doesn't matter how big your pond is. Let's say it's 10 acres. I run an electrofishing survey. This is what we pretty standard of what you would see on a fairly unmanaged fishery, where you have a single bell curve with the most abundance of fish, or somewhere between 12 and 14 inches. So what we would immediately do to improve this fishery is we'd set a harvest regulation to where we're removing fish 12 to 14 or 12 to 15 inches and trying to flatten that bell curve and force more fish beyond that size. And if you'll scroll down, Nathan, this is what this is, that red line. There's a weight, a standard weight that every fish should weigh based on its length. That red line is the standard weight. Whenever we look at that population, if we compare the lengths of those fish to their actual weights, every green dot, what you would want to see on a balanced fishery is those green dots to be on the red line. For a fishery where, like Denny described, where fish are fat and actively growing, those green dots would be above the red line. They're more than 100% of what they should weigh for their length. In an unbalanced fishery, they'll be below that line. And like Denny said, as an advanced angler, he can look at a fish and say, this fish is not healthy, I should remove it. You could technically, if you had the time, you could take the length and weight on every single fish you caught that fell within the legal harvest regulation. And if it, in a relative weight calculator, fell below that line, you could remove it. And that would be like being the most scientific advanced angler possible. Because you would be using the exact formula we use on our boats whenever we're assessing fish populations and setting regulations. You'd be doing that, working within the regulation that you're legally allowed to harvest fish. You could do that. Or if you maybe are a legendary professional angler, you can just look at the fish and have that instinct to know if that fish is below the line. But this is what we're looking at to make a harvest regulation. In every private pond that I get into, the very first time out without seeing it, I know we're going to have to set a harvest regulation. We're going to have to remove fish. And most our reservoirs are skewing the same way.
Denny, I love that chart. It shows me exactly what you were talking about. If you see the fish is emaciated or thinner than he should be, it makes an easy choice to harvest it. But I worry that a lot of people who catch a fish that's really skinny, I worry that those people think that fish is unhealthy in a way that makes it inedible. What do you think? I would worry that it's a diseased fish.
Well, I certainly don't know the answer to that, but I do know here on the lake I live on, if you see a skinny fish, more than likely it's got plastic in its belly. And that's a real, I think the one thing the average angler needs to do is make sure he doesn't discard plastic and, you know, do everything you can if you do catch one of those skinny fish to see if you can remove that plastic from their stomach, because that's what kills a lot of these big fish.
I'm sorry, Steven, before you go to that chart again, Denny, another thing that I think is a nice analogy, maybe, because you're such an outstanding hunter, as we see in the background of your shot there. My gosh, look at those things. The reason Denny doesn't eat fish is because he's got so much venison. But when if you're hunting on your...
Yeah.
What's that?
There's a lot of truth to that.
Amen. I've been to Denny's home when he was still in Missouri, and from his back deck, he could shoot deer. Pretty much any day of the season he wanted to. But, you know, when you're hunting your own land or land you manage and you see a scrub buck, it's an easy call to make. You pull the trigger, you harvest that deer. It seems like in the world of fish, though, it's a lot more problematic. Would you say that? Is that a fair statement, Denny?
I think so. I think it is. You know, and it becomes a judgment call without a doubt. But, to me, if you're seeing several skinny fish, it's a forage issue. It's not a health issue from that standpoint. And, you know, that's when you got to start removing them. It's easy to do on smaller bodies of water to make that judgment. Not quite as easy on major bodies of water.
Bert, that brings me to a point you were making. You were talking about in Southeast Georgia, where you were the regional fisheries supervisor for many years. You worked on a lot of smaller reservoirs, from a few hundred acres to a few thousand acres. Because you were working with a more contained environment, did your fisheries bounce back faster when you initiated a new management program than a Lanier?
Absolutely.
Or
we
no
had
Tony?
Public fishing. Yeah, absolutely. Some of the public fishing areas here would bounce. I mean, you would see even some of the lakes around town, 50 acre lakes that we managed, we'd remove 200 or 300 of these small 8 to 12 inch bass, which is private lake, so you could do that. We'd remove a couple hundred just fishing, just see the poor condition on these fish and the poor growth rates and the big eyes, like, guys, we got to do something here. And it was a small enough group of folks fishing it that we would take out 200 or 300. You'd see a response in 2 months. I mean, just tremendous. Where a system under 100 acres, you'll see quick responses, but it doesn't produce the quality of like a 500 to 800 acre lake. The quantity of what you're dealing with is not there. So you see a bigger, more return for your effort, but on a big reservoir, if everybody gets together and if they're selectively harvesting, you're going to see a difference. It's just a much bigger effort, much bigger scale on those larger systems.
Denny, I'm loving what I'm hearing from all you guys about the harvest element of it, but I'm thinking, what would be the attitude? Not that I necessarily care what everybody thinks, but Denny, what would be the attitude if a Denny Brauer on his way home from a fishing trip stops to fill up his gas tank and his buddies hear a bunch of fish splashing around in the live well? That might not go over well.
You know,
what's that?
I'd tell them they were stripers.
And don't post on Facebook.
That's a good answer. That's a brilliant answer.
Fish.
I like, you know, that answer.
That's another question I have for these guys. With the advancement of electronics, are they worried that that's going to become a management problem? I hear people complaining about the crappie are really being diminished in certain lakes because the anglers are getting so good at catching them because of the advancements. Do you guys talk about that stuff? Is it going to become a factor?
I love that you brought this up, Denny, because I think this goes to answer the question for the night as well. Whenever you sit in a room and you have this question of how impactful is something like forward-facing sonar, it always goes back to what is the end result of that fish catch? If the end result of that fish catch is the harvest or the removal of that fish, then we have to worry about that technology increasing the exploitation of either a size class or species of fish. And with crappie, even some large catfish species, walleye, that becomes a real relevant question. Even sunfish, large sunfish, that becomes a real relevant question. Whenever it comes to bass, everybody sits back in the room and says, well, bass anglers don't harvest fish, so it's probably not going to have the impact. And that that is truthful. Bert, would you agree that we're worried about fish that are going to be easily exploited and we're not worried about bass?
Absolutely. Not as much. I've seen it in crappie fisheries where it concerns me that a lot of the bigger crappie are leaving. Small systems that are known for producing 3-pound crappie are no longer producing 3-pound crappie. But it's very much in the discussion the last 3, 4, 5 years, very much in the discussion, more intently for crappie than bass. I agree with you there, but no conclusions yet. I've seen a couple studies coming out saying catch rates are fairly similar. No smoking gun. I mean, no, nothing. I haven't seen any studies saying that, oh my gosh, it's decimating everything. But it's definitely been in the discussions, Denny.
Bert.
Well, we've actually started some surveys. We started some surveys on our systems just to track what percentage of our anglers are using forward facing sonar. It's pretty low right now on our systems.
But the type of angler that you're most concerned with would be a professional guide that can have a group of clients that they could take out. They could capture the fish really quickly. They could have a great day. They could leave. They could take another group out that afternoon. That's the group of anglers that will have the greatest impact. And species like crappie that are going to school together and they can be exploited for multiple days in one location. That's really tough on. And they also are kind of intermediate spawners. You don't get a consistent spawn from crappie every season. So.
You said you're having, you know, these lakes aren't kicking out 3-pound crappie. If more crappie are being taken out, shouldn't they size the upper end go up?
It will. That's right. The fewer mouths, the bigger that are there. But yeah. you can pluck them out.
Right. With forward facing, it's you're catching the bigger ones that you never could before because they're grumps out there on by themselves. I got you. We haven't talked about, so we've kind of got into, culling bass out of the system. I say culling, I mean pulling them out of the system. But we haven't talked about, pulling crappie out of the system, pickerel, muskie, pike, other apex species in order to benefit the largemouth. And how does that play into this situation, Steve?
It's not a zero-sum game because you have different trophic levels where your largemouth aren't directly competing against crappie specifically. So removing a crappie doesn't benefit a largemouth directly. Or removing something like a pike or a pickerel doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to have a better largemouth fishery. Fisheries are much more dynamic than that. And you have various food chains that are occurring in one place. And usually largemouth sit at the top of a lot of those systems because as those other fish are juveniles, they're being consumed by largemouth. And largemouth can be so various on what they can consume. So it's not really a zero-sum game like that, Brian, where you can't say, I want to improve this bass fishery. Number one, no agency would take that stated approach that this is only a bass fishery. It's more diverse. But if they did, they wouldn't say, I want to improve this bass fishery, and the best way to do it is to remove pike. That would be very difficult to correlate in something that we can measure scientifically and show the result of.
I would
vote. Oh, and smaller bodies of water, smaller ponds and such.
Pond. I'm gonna rote note it and start over and only put bass in there.
Yeah, because from what I've heard, crappie are the number one competitor to a largemouth for the forage.
Crappie utilize soft forage like minnow species, shad species, and largemouth. They have a diversity of forage, and really a lot of it's based on sunfish in your small ponds. So it's not necessarily that the crappie compete for food. They compete for space. And in a pond, you start talking about even dissolved oxygen becomes really important. The amount of dissolved oxygen, if you have hundreds of thousands of crappie, can crash overnight during the summer. So it's a lot more nuanced because it's such a small system, and small changes can create big impacts.
So eat the crappie is what Steve Bardin recommends everybody.
Absolutely. And the bass.
Oh, and the bass.
Well, I don't eat as much bass as I'd like, quite honestly, and I hesitate to say that in front of my friend Denny Brauer, but for fear he might punch me. But
you're safe.
Well, yeah, I'm in Florida. You're in. I'm sorry. I'm in an undisclosed location, and you're in Texas. But yeah, I want to get as close as we can to some guidelines for all of us bass anglers as to how we can be more engaged in the harvest system. And I love Steven's chart where we saw all those underweight fish, and Denny's comment about spotting an undersized fish and knowing that's a fish that would benefit from harvest because there's not enough to eat out there. But guys, are there any, is this one of those situations where we need to talk to our area biologist and get a feel for it? Or can you offer us some sort of generalized guidelines for what we can do to help with regard to harvest? Because I've always had this nebulous idea that I'm not taking, well, A, I'm not catching enough fish because I'm not Denny Brauer. B, I'm probably not harvesting enough of the fish that I catch.
Yeah, Ken,
you kind of have to be.
Go ahead,
Steve.
Sorry, Bert, you're up.
Well, you kind of you have to be a little more deliberate about it, Ken, because a lot of times you're not planning, you're not used to keeping them. I mean, you just have to be deliberate that, hey, today I'm going to keep some. I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to plan on it because it's not worth filleting two fish. Generally, oh, general, it's not worth it. So if you're deliberate, hey, I've got time. Do what, Ken?
I was going to say that's exactly part of the hurdle for me. It is messy. It is inconvenient. It is time consuming to clean fish. And unless you've got enough for a meal, you know, you almost hate to do it.
That's right.
So like you said,
if you're deliberate. Yeah, if you know that the partner that you're going with that day, if practicing with or whatever, if you've got time, I mean, I do the same thing when I go fishing. There's days when I harvest fish. There's days when I know going out, I'm not harvesting fish that day. I get the stinky eye from my wife every now and then when I decide I'm not going. So you're not bringing home any food today, huh? That's just the way it is. But being deliberate about it, because we've all gotten out. There was probably a period of, well, when I was 16 to 25, I mean, all I cared about doing was catching bass, and I didn't keep a single fish during that time period. And you just have to be deliberate. Take your cooler, take the ice, prepare to harvest them. And then it's not as big of a deal because it's pretty simple now. I mean, I'll go out if I'm crappie fishing or planning on keeping a few small bass or whatever. And I know going in usually, hey, I'm planning on keeping them today or I'm not. And then you just plan, you set yourself a goal. And you keep 8 or 10, or if you want to keep enough for tonight's meal and then one meal for the freezer, that's going to help. Most systems, that's going to help. And then selectively, and then you hope the bite's good enough that you can do that.
Denny, you mentioned the shad population being a little low perhaps on Amistad right now, and the fish aren't as fat as they have been at different times. And with that, knowing that you're catching a number of skinny fish, would that make you more inclined to keep them and take them home?
It would if a biologist told me that was truly the case. You know, we can't totally tell what's going on underneath the water and what the percentage of forage should be there. I see quite a few schools of bait on my electronics. I think at times lakes become very stressed. especially when they are low, like we're 62 feet low right now. So, you know, there's a lot going on with this fishery that in a healthy fishery, you wouldn't have to combat. So there's always a lot of factors, but it still goes back to bait. They got to have something to eat. And, you know, there's a lot of people, in order to justify it, they need to keep some fish to eat to bring home. And I totally understand that, but it goes back to when I'm at the cleaning station or whatever, cleaning a few stripers, if I'm keeping them, and I see some guy come with a great big bath chopping its head off, I've got issues with that. If you're going to keep fish, I think, you know, look at the smaller ones, keep them. But, man, them big old brood bass, it just kills me to see somebody keep them. That does not make sense. But a lot of things don't make sense to me. The guy that live wells, you know, 7-pound bass all day long and keeps four or five of them so he can get a picture holding up four or five fish at the end of the day. And he stressed those fish out. I mean, if you want to take a picture, hold it up, take a picture and let it go immediately, and that fish is going to be fine. But don't drag him around all day just for that glory shot.
Yeah, I mentioned earlier, I once chopped the head off a 12, but in my defense, I was 12 years old, and I had a middle school football game later that day. So nobody should punch me for that.
Denny, when's the last time you punched somebody at the fish cleaning stations on Amistad? Off the record. Off the record.
Before we let Denny go, I'm gonna tell a story about how the only professional angler I was ever in fear of was Denny Brauer one day. So that's the only professional angler I was ever in fear of interviewing one day. But we'll tell that story at the end here. Right. Steven, any advice on identifying a fair number of fish to harvest, or is that everybody's mentioned it's a case by case basis and so forth. And I totally get that, but for somebody who doesn't know his biologist doesn't.
Yep. Yeah. I think there's a few things there. Number one, if you're fishing a public reservoir, I'm going to assume you have a fishing license, which gives you the legal right to harvest those fish that are based on the regulation. If you pull open your regulation book and you see a special regulation for that reservoir, you can tell that the biologist has signed off that says this needs to happen for whatever reason. You're hoping that their reason is they want the fishery to improve in the exact same way you do. That may not be the case, but you're hoping that. So if you're fishing a reservoir with a special regulation, you can trust that some harvest is needed for whatever reason, because that's why that's in place. If you're fishing in a state like Florida, Ken, that has changed their statewide regulation to be from being a several numbers of different regulations to one singular regulation that now allows you to harvest fish under 16 inches, you can trust that the entire state is behind the fact that this has to change. And that's a 2023, if I'm correct, regulation change. They're telling you right now this has to happen. And as a license holder, and somebody who I would think is pretty involved in fisheries conservation as an angler, it's your obligation to participate. So I think that's big.
That's a bold statement. That's a bold statement. Yeah, to say it's a responsibility. I like it.
I think the last part goes back to exactly what Denny said, and I would reiterate the point that to put large fish in your live well, if you were pulled over by a game warden in the middle of your day and you had 4 7-pound fish in your live well, those fish are considered harvested. The game warden would write you a citation if you were over the number of fish or those were the wrong size of fish, because in their mind, those are harvested fish. And a percentage of fish that are put into a live well or go through a tournament, we know are going to have mortality. We figure that into regulation changes, is the number of tournaments that are going to be there, the number of fish that are going to be caught, the number of fish that on a probability scale are going to die. Now, we don't know which individual fish those are and how impactful that will be, but that's figured into a regulation change. So when Denny Brauer says he's going to come punch you for putting 7-pounders in your live well, I take that serious.
I take everything Denny says seriously. He knows that.
Yeah, right.
let's talk about size and harvest again, because one thing that there seems to be a real consensus on is that if we're harvesting fish, they should be typically a more modest size, say 16 inches and below. Is that a statement that everybody can get behind here? Bert, what do you think? I'm assuming it's within the regs, let's say. In the South,
that would be about the systems I'm familiar with: Florida, Georgia, Alabama, South Carolina. That area, that's pretty accurate because our growth rates are higher. I can't speak for other parts of the country, but the systems that I deal with, that's about right. I've got some that just aren't real productive, that it makes more sense for 12 to 14 inches and under, because they just don't have the productivity to bump them up. You're not going to see much benefit. And that, it's tough to say six. That's pretty accurate unless you've got a super unproductive system. The 16 inches. It's hard to say that, though. I mean, it's hard to set a rule like that just because of the differences in the different regions of our country.
I mentioned that 16 inch thing only because, you know, that's a 2.5 pound fish or whatever. And you're getting a fair amount of meat out of mm-hmm. a fish like that. But it's not so big that it's a challenge to clean, or you right. maybe not feel like you're hurting the resource. So that seemed like a reasonable range right there. Steven, what are your thoughts on the best sizes to harvest?
I actually liked the statement that Bert said about 12 to 14 inch fish. I think that there's a lot of value there, because then you would disproportionately be harvesting more males than females. You know, females don't stay in that small size class as long as males. So if we're talking about how do I want to impact a fishery as quick as possible, males don't, I mean, yes, they guard fry, but they don't really dictate spawning success as much as a female does. A female, as she increases in size, her eggs grow larger. That means her fry are larger. She becomes more valuable. So I love the general statement, let's just do 16 and under. I also really like 12 to 14 because we can get more males out of the system. And if we're really getting nitpicky, that's how you make a fishery better.
Now, occasionally we'll see a creel limits that are even allow you to harvest fish below 12 inches. And I got a problem with that only because who wants to keep a fish that small? I'm imagining that harvest a fish under 12 inches, that's really only happening by panfish anglers, probably, right? Who are getting a largemouth as bycatch.
Right. And they're going to gut the fish and consume it whole, or, you know, that's definitely true. But at the same time,
on our public fishing areas, that's exactly what we're seeing. Yeah. It's so smaller. The panfish anglers are generally catching those undersized fish. And when we have a regulation where we have one over 16 or whatever on that system, that's generally who's harvesting those small ones. But that's okay. I mean, we encourage. I mean, when we see our anglers and talk to our anglers out on our areas, it's like, please keep those smaller bass. It's going to help the system, and we'll explain to them why. And sometimes they do, but almost always it's the panfish anglers that eats the minnow or eats the jig that's trolled, and they'll keep a 10-inch bass. But there are systems. I mean, that's part of it. Depending on what you set that regulation at, you want them to keep those small fish.
When we do it on our electrofishing boat, one of the things I tell my clients about those fish under 12 inches is I explain to them the resource management aspect of this. It takes somewhere around 10 pounds of live forage to take a fish from a fry to a 1 pound fish. And as we start talking about the size class of forage that they're eating, that becomes thousands of fish that they have to consume to get to a 1 pound fish. So by removing that, you can save 1,000 food items. And when we start in a pond, it becomes super simple because they're also have a value to that forage because they bought it. But they can understand that as a dollar value. So if I said every one of those food items is 50 cents, and then you're the pond owner and you're like, well, 1,000 times 50, all of a sudden I'm saving $500 by removing one bass. it's a very simplistic scale, but that becomes an impactful decision.
Denny, you've got more experience fishing all over the country than the rest of us combined, I'm sure. I know that I used to fish Dale Hollow quite a bit, where I think for decades, they've had a slot between like 16 and 21 inches. And I'll be damned if every fish I catch is not between 16 and 21 inches. It's why, you know, organizations like BASS and so forth never have a tournament there, because they can't get them to waive that reg. Denny, do you see other fisheries that are like that, where almost every fish you catch is in a slot?
It does seem that way a lot of times as a fisherman when we go to these different bodies of water. Irregardless, if it's a 15-inch size limit, you catch a lot of 14.5-inch fish, etc. But, you know, I'm not a biologist by any means. I do think that there is a factor on some lakes, because they're going to keep everything that they absolutely can catch, that it can be a factor where, you know, them slot limits especially become a real, real deal. But everybody's water is so different, Ken, that you just can't make a general statement on that.
When you see, this is, well, anybody wants to jump in on this one. When you see a slot limit like the Dale Hollow 16 to 21 on smallmouths, and it's been in place for decades, does that tell you it's not working, or that it is working? Or does it tell you nothing at all?
The answer to it, I do know that when you see a lake where you're not getting many bites and the fish are skinny, that there's an issue there and something needs to be addressed. Do you need more fish, or do you need more forage, and or the fish just not biting? But if it goes on for years, I think somebody's dropping the ball that's managing those lakes.
That's what I'm wondering, because I assume that I always assume there's a rationale or a reason for something, no matter what it is, whether it seems like it makes sense to me or it's stupid. But when you have the same reg in place like that, a relatively sophisticated slot limit, that's a big slot limit, 16 to 21 on smallmouth, and it hasn't changed, as far as I know, in 20 years. And I'm curious as to whether that's a good sign or a bad sign, or if you can't tell.
And my question would be to the biologist. I mean, ask them, look at the data. Hey, what's happened over this last decades, or show me how this reg is working. And they should have that. They should have the yearly sampling and the quality of the fish, the condition factors, catch rates. They should have all of that stuff. Creel surveys to see what people are catching. If they're off 15 3/4 inches, or actually 16.5, I guess. Yeah.
That's been my experience there. Ordinarily, I think of a slot limit as trying to protect that range. Maybe that 16 to 21 is a great spawning size, and they feel like they need more fish, so they're protecting them. But mm-hmm. to do it for 20 plus years, I don't know. It just seems odd. But that's a great point, Bert. Obviously, I need to talk to the biologist out there, and I just haven't been up there in a long time, so it hasn't been top of mind. But would that be the traditional rationale for a slot like that, to protect the spawning class fish? Steven is nodding, but he's not talking.
Yeah, that would be it. And I mean, it could be recreation. I mean, my brain stopped working. Sorry.
I keep talking, Bert, when that happens.
They may be keeping their visitation.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah,
because the catch rates it could be a whole host of reasons.
Yeah, that I had not considered mm-hmm. that.
Then it may be working. Size.
Yeah, it's good for mm-hmm. tourism. Had not considered that.
I quit Correct. Talking.
That's the word I couldn't find.
So I quit talking because Major League Fishing's going to Dale Hollow.
I love that. I saw that on the schedule. I think that's a cool and bold move.
Yeah. And so I'm, as part of my position, one of the things I do is set the minimum scoreable weight that the anglers will compete under. In this reg, it's difficult because, you know, to make a legal smallmouth fit into this event is a challenge. and I don't have historic data. I just have the last 3 years of electrofishing data. And so it's a snapshot, and I'm just looking at average size. And over the last 3 years, the average weight of the smallmouth have slightly decreased in their electrofishing sampling. And once again, this is I'm just clicking through it real quick, but it looks like to me the spotted bass have increased in abundance in their sampling data. So I haven't studied Del Hollow, but what I would tell you is they're trying to protect that spawning class of smallmouth, and specifically from hybridization with spotted bass.
That
would be my instinct.
Well, I would tell you that on July 9th, 1955, David Hayes caught the world record there, 11 pounds, 15 ounces. I would set the minimum scoreable at 12 pounds even.
And turn just go.
And turn it into a world record chase.
Yeah, so, no.
I think Denny would want back in the BPT if you do that.
Steven, Paul Benson on the message board wanted to know, when you're electrofishing, what's your favorite color to use?
Yeah. That's a really good question.
Yeah, stained water.
Stained water, yeah. Anything aluminum works great.
Okay. All right, there you go, Paul.
That is a great question. I had not heard that question before.
So, Steve, let's give some examples. Lay this out. Take some lakes that are on the MLF schedule this year, or some other very famous, popular lakes that, in your opinion, would need fish called out.
Well, sorry, would be what?
Would need fish called out, where you think that they have too many fish.
Yeah. Toledo Bend. How about Santa Cooper? How about Del Hollow? We can go historically, fisheries like Watts Bar, Table Rock Lake. We're going to Lake Eufaula in Oklahoma this year. That'd be a good one to harvest fish.
Table Rock has too many bass?
Wow. Well, I think the list would be shorter on what reservoirs didn't need some harvest. And even if I look at Toledo Bend data versus Sam Rayburn data, you can see that there's a slight increase in harvest at Toledo Bend compared to Sam Rayburn. And those fisheries are, I don't know, 60 miles apart. One of them happens to have a more consumptive angler population coming out of Louisiana. Their harvest rate is higher at Toledo Bend, but it's a larger fishery. Yeah, it can sustain it. You also in any time you get coastal, you have a shorter lifespan of your fish. And as you move north, that lifespan increases. So there's some nuances there, but almost every fishery, if you see a minimum under 2 pounds from me, you will know that that fishery needs harvest.
I got you. How about Lake Champlain?
At times, yeah, especially on the largemouth side.
Denny, yeah. you won 19 tournaments in your BASS career, which is amazing. What an accomplishment. And although you did well everywhere under any conditions and you won tournaments, a lot of people will always identify you as a guy who made a living with a flipping stick in his hand, but you won tournaments using spinner baits, using all kinds of different things. But you always really excelled on the tougher fisheries, where maybe there weren't as many fish as in some of the bodies of water Steven was just listing. So I think it's kind of ironic that a guy, and so many pros like the tough tournaments. They want it to be a gutted out, grinded out kind of deal. What was it about the tougher tournaments that helped you excel? Was it the mindset or the style? What helped you excel in those tournaments?
Yeah, I think it's probably a combination of things, Ken. You got the mindset in a tough tournament that you could probably outwork people and maybe make a few better decisions on a really good fishery where there's a lot of fish and they're easy to catch. I think the luck factor becomes a little bit greater, where maybe some anglers that aren't quite as proficient have an easier chance of big bag. So I think that's the primary difference. I think in tough fisheries, tough conditions, you'll see your better anglers have a chance to rise to the top.
That was certainly the case with you. If it was a tough derby, whether it be on the Arkansas River or High Rock or wherever, you were always going to be up there at the top. And not that you didn't whack them when it was a tear them up fest either, but you certainly did well in the tough ones. So Denny might advocate for, you know, a ton of harvest. Let's get rid of some of these bass so that he can win more.
I don't think you live on Amistad if you don't want to catch big fish. If you want to catch big fish, we need to harvest more small fish.
I'm just kidding about that, but I think it's interesting.
I got a question for
you. Yeah, go ahead. Okay.
No, stay on topic. It's mine slightly off.
I went kind of far off topic there, but I had to ask Denny that question.
Well, I was curious, Denny, like, how thankful are you that you were born and fished when you did, and you're not out there with the forward facing?
Actually, very thankful, I guess. I love the diversity of styles that we had coming up through the years. Different guys had different strengths and different ways of catching them. And now it just seems like it's a one-way highway. And I'm not saying that's wrong or right, but it's something I don't think I'd enjoy as much. And I just think anytime you're coming up, well, a sport is really growing. And I think it was really growing in the 80s and 90s. I think that's the ideal time to be involved. And I wouldn't change it. And I had a great career, and I'm tickled to death for it.
Yeah, I think professional bass fishing on a lot of levels peaked in the late 80s, early 90s. And Denny was on top of his game
then. Yeah, men could be men, you know?
Although I still maintain that 98 was not only Denny's best year, but I think the best year any angler has ever had. But now we digress. We got to bring Denny back for a show that we call "Is the Flippin' Era Over in Professional Bass?" I think it's a fair question, but that's not the question we had tonight, gentlemen. Tonight we were talking about, has catch and release gone too far? Let's kind of wrap this up a little bit. I want to ask you each in turn the same question, but maybe phrased in a different way. Has catch and release outlived a lot of its usefulness? Let me ask it that way. Has catch and release outlived a lot of its usefulness? And Bert, let's start with you. Start with a yes or no, and then certainly explain.
Yes. I would give that one a quick yes, and not the whole concept, but that we need to shift it more towards selective harvest as opposed to just straight catch and release. That's the way that I would phrase it, and that's what I've been the last decade of my career. That's what I spent helping people understand why that would be a good plan.
Very good.
I mean, to follow up on that, is it feasible to think that there can be a formula where you take that particular lake's tournament data, because where else are you going to get data from? But you just take that lake's tournament data, you know, even just the weights that it puts out, and be able to formulate some kind of guidelines on you know, what the catch and release rate should be. Think that's a possibility? Bert?
I think some of the other data, that's definitely part of it, is that you need to have the catch data from tournaments. And actually, I wasn't thinking about it from a tournament standpoint. I think catch and release is still the way we need to go on a tournament, unless the organization is going to start harvesting those small fish. I mean, that... it depends on how big of a scale you want to take it to, because reality is, if that release boat does not release all the fish between 12 and 14 inches and they give them to a food bank somewhere, that's a very valid way to start removing fish. Oh. I was talking just in an angler on an everyday fishing trip. So there's two different ways to look at this, and I didn't even consider the tournament way of it, but that could... definitely catch and release needs to still continue for those four or five. And I sure don't want Denny chopping my head or hitting me if I chop a big fish's head. That isn't appropriate. So catch and release on those fish are still appropriate, totally. But there are, if an organization wants to be forward thinking, they can have an effect on some of these reservoirs. Obviously, work with the biologist to determine what's needed there. But a straight catch and release isn't always the best thing for a system.
Steven Bardin, I am so excited that the BPT is going to Dale Hollow. I think you guys are going to be able to give the Tennessee Wildlife Resources folks some amazing data about the fish size out there. And I'll be curious as to whether they see it as an opportunity to make a change, or to Bert's terrific point, if that's really a tourism play. But let me ask you the same question. Yes or no first, but then certainly explain. Has catch and release outlived much of its usefulness?
Yes, it needs to evolve, just as Bert described. I think here's the very difficult part of major league fishing is we as tournament fishermen need to push for catch, weigh, and immediate release events, because we can decrease our impact on advanced size large fish. And we could utilize, just like Bert said, some harvest. You could do that in an event. I mean, our anglers, especially when they're up north, I have watched our anglers catch a walleye during competition and put it in the live well and say, this is what we're going to have for dinner tonight, and then go on and continue to catch smallmouth and weigh them in. I would challenge any of our BPT anglers. You could do the same thing with a 1 pound, 8 ounce bass. That's a legal fish. It's not a scoreable fish in our competition. Put it in your live well and harvest that fish. And I would challenge really all state agencies to look at the impact of tournaments and start thinking about catch, weight, and immediate release. And I know I've had this conversation with you, Ken. I think if Ray Scott was here today and owned Bassmaster and was really could find a way to leverage that, even if that technology was originally available in the 70s and we would have had cameras on the boats, we would have been doing catch, weight, and immediate release back then.
I believe it. Yeah, I believe it.
So but we do have to be careful, because promote catch, weight, and immediate release and not caveat it with, we do need selective harvest as well. I have to keep that as part of the relevant conversation, because as we promote that and it continues to become more popular, we can't let the thought process be our professional anglers no longer even live well fish. So we shouldn't ever put fish in a live well. We shouldn't ever remove fish from fishery. Selective harvest still has to be part of that conversation and will become more relevant as tournaments become less impactful.
Wonderful points. And you know what? At first I agreed with you. Yes, Ray would use the technology to have immediate catch, weigh, and release. But then Denny, and you're the guy I need to go to on this one. But then I realized Ray loved the microphone and the big stage too much. I don't think Ray would have given that up. And if he had catch, weigh, and release, he wouldn't have had the big stage and the microphone, and he wouldn't have had the tasseled jackets. So I'm not sure Ray would have gone that way.
Well, he also made a lot of money off anglers guessing the weight of the bat. So
that's true. A dollar at a time. How many times did he take your money on those bets?
Not that often. I got him a few times and made him sign the dollars.
I love that. All right, Denny Brauer, here's the question. Yes or no, and then explain, has catch and release outlived much of its usefulness?
I don't know whether that is a yes or no. That's the hard part about this whole question you brought up. If I'd have to answer one way, I'd say no, because of the number of people that do not know which fish need to be removed, and they end up taking the fish that are very, very precious out of the body of the water. I totally understand removing the smaller fish to keep a fishery in balance, but man, for somebody to take a big fish out and kill it, that makes absolutely
fuck them up. Beat their ass, Danny.
That's a great point. Yeah, if you don't know which ones to harvest, you can do a lot of damage. BTC?
If you harvested 10 pounders, you're an asshole, is what Danny was saying.
I could put it better.
Yeah. Guys, cannot thank you enough for joining us tonight. That's been a really great discussion. I have learned a ton, and I hope the folks watching and listening have learned as much, because this has been really enlightening. And BTC, can you escort our guest out here?
Yes. Denny, it's a pleasure, man.
Let's hang on to Denny for just a little bit, because I have a story to tell on Denny.
Okay.
Let's hold on to him for last.
All right. Bert, it's been real, homie. I felt rude. I got some.
That's a classy way out. That's a classy way out.
I can't even snap anymore. Let me get my arm up here. Steve, good conversation tonight, man. I have got some things to reach out to you about. We were talking about earlier, but awesome stuff, dude. Talk to you soon.
Had to hang on to the legend, Mr. Brauer, because he's one of my favorite people that I have met through my time in the sport. And he knows what a fan I am of him. But there was one day when I was afraid of him. It was a day in 2010, a final day of end of day two at the Bassmaster Classic. And Denny had zeroed the first day, and then he zeroed the second day. And what you had to understand about Denny, certainly at this point of his career, but over much of his career, was there was either winning or losing. If you did not win, you lost, and he only cared about winning. But that didn't mean that he wasn't occasionally pissed off about not winning. He was usually pissed off about not winning. And after zeroing 2 days in a row at the Bassmaster Classic, he was not in a great mood. But I was in the boatyard, and I'm, you know, looking, hey, I got a chance to interview Denny Brauer, you know, one of my favorite people. I wasn't sure if he was going to answer my question or just take a swing at me. But what was always great about Denny was when you needed him, he was money. He was always a great interview. He was always gracious. He always had a ton of class, and he didn't take a swing at me ever. So, Denny, I appreciate you.
You're more than welcome. I appreciate all you did for my career.
If I did anything at all, it's been my pleasure. You're, like I said, you're not just one of the all-time greats. You're one of my all-time favorite people in the sport. Thank you so much for joining us on Bass After Dark. You're wonderful.
Hold on. I didn't snap him out yet.
Yeah. BTC's got to take you out. He's got only one arm to work with after shoulder surgery. But
keep
thanks,
talking.
Man.
I'm looking for something. Ken,
I don't know what he's
looking
for.
Find me a minute.
I've got your Wheaties box in my office, and I meant to have it sitting here. So I screwed up.
Yeah, me too.
I had Denny sign that Wheaties box 25 years ago, almost now. Yeah. So, to be on the Wheaties box. Okay. Let's talk about I'm not going to ask you to pick a tournament you're most proud of, but tell me one accomplishment or one thing you did as a result of all your tournament success that is the most memorable, or that you're most proud of, like the Wheaties box, the Letterman appearances, the things like that. What would it be? Not a tournament, but something that came as a result of it.
I guess probably the Letterman appearances, because I realized how far reaching that was for the sport of bass fishing, and that we're going to possibly bring more people to the sport and introduce them to the sport because of the audience that he had. We were reaching different people. So that probably, it was the most nerve-wracking, I know that.
Well, let's see. Now, on one of your Letterman appearances, you were supposed to be on with, like, Jesse Jackson or something, right?
Correct.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. But Jackson was late arriving, I think. I would just tell people that they bumped Jesse Jackson to have you on longer. That's what I would tell people.
I probably got more airtime than any guest ever did. Letterman show because of his plane being late, so it worked out pretty good.
That's fantastic. Well, Denny, thanks for so much of your time tonight, man. We really do appreciate you.
Thank you.
So I found it, Denny. Back in the day, back in the late 80s, early 90s, when we were like really just getting into stuff. I don't know if it was just an article in Bassmaster where you talked about flipping into the cup in your living room, practicing your pitching. And it was brand new to us up here in New Jersey, and so we were trying to figure it all out. But remember, you know, talking about flipping into a cup, and beginning of COVID, I had made this thing here, which was the tin cup flipping box, but harkens back to you, dude.
I appreciate
flipping in the cups.
You
invented it, Denny. Yeah, man. I mean, dude, thank you very much, Denny. You're the greatest.
Thank you, guys.
Take care. And then it's just the two of us, BTC.
Oh, my word. Yes, sir.
All right, man. I got to ask you. Has catch and release outlived much of its usefulness?
I'm not convinced. I've heard the arguments made for it. I can't relate it to the area I'm in. And, you know, it's going to take just more conversation. And like I said, we're looking at it in a broad scope over the country.
Yeah.
But it's something that relates to each individual lake. And to come up with a formula, like, you know, all right, every tournament's won here with under 10 pounds. Now, obviously, the region of the country is a big factor in that. But when you can take stuff like that, because it's tournament related, and just kind of get a feel on the lake, all right, now we start to know, like, this place has got problems. Either it doesn't have enough bass or it's got too many small bass, you know. So that's where I'm at. I just need more data, you know. Like, if you got a 50 boat tournament and there's only three limits brought in, maybe how are you going to tell me that lake needs fish pulled out?
Maybe your club sucks. I don't know.
Yeah, well, there's that, Kat. Well, you know, I thought we were being serious for a minute.
Well, I agree that there's no one size fits all answer here, but I think we got some great parameters to work with. I love Denny's comment and what Steven and Bert were talking about too, about if you can see a fish is below weight for its length, or the eyes
beat
are
his
big.
Ass.
Who did you know the thing about the eye size? I didn't know that.
No, I could look off their mouth, right? Like if the fish is 4 pounds, if the fish is 5 pounds, I could fit my fist in his mouth. You know, anything like that, that's how you could tell. So when you have a fish that's 6, 7, 8 pounds and you can't, that's a young ass fish, you know, but you get that thing that's weighing 3 pounds. He's got that big goggle head. You can put your fish in his mouth, fist in his mouth. Yeah, he toast.
Yeah. Well, it's there is no one size fits all, but I really enjoyed the conversation tonight. I hope the folks watching and listening did too. And I know I learned a lot. It's time for bad comments.
Yes, bad comments. And we have the top 10.
Oh my gosh.
Stick around, guys. Hang in there.
We have dark thoughts too. Let's bring in, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a special intro created by none other than the great Nathan Benson for our next segment, which is called Bad Comments with our intern, Jacob Morrison.
For someone to say that's the JP, that's an easy.
I love that.
Dude fishes with Biden.
I saw that. Yeah, dude fishes with Biden. That's really good. Jacob, welcome back.
Thank you. I think I have the best intro in bass fishing.
Oh, wow. I think you might. You just might.
Yeah. I don't even have one.
That was really cool. Well, you know, Jacob, when we talked about bad comments at the top of the show, we wanted to let people know that it's not necessarily about bad, mean-spirited comments about the show. It's also... If anybody has a question to ask of Jacob Morrison or Brian Stockel or Nathan Benson or Ken Duke, an opportunity to roll some of those out there. So we hope we got a mix. But what's it look like in the comments world?
All right. So in the comments world, we're going to start off with our MVP of bad comments tonight. Yes. And that's going to be Brandon Ackerson, who starts us off with, "Why does Ken look like he lives at the Playboy Mansion after the ladies left?"
Okay, Brandon. You know, when we originally conceived the idea of Bass After Dark, we wanted to have a certain vibe or feel. We wanted it to feel a little bit like a late night talk show, a little bit like a party at Hefner's speakeasy. House, something like that, a speakeasy. We wanted it to have that vibe. And so I rolled out the idea half jokingly that I'd wear a smoking jacket and an ascot. And Nathan and Brian really liked that. And I don't know, foolishly perhaps, let them choose the color. So we went with purple to match our logo. And lo and behold, I am in a purple smoking jacket with a silver ascot and pocket square.
Giacomo.
All right.
Woo!
Brandon again. BTC. Again. A bell curve is the backside of a Southern girl.
I love that comment. Brandon Iverson, he's a champion tonight. Jacob's going to send you something. I don't know what it is.
Me?
Yeah, your best lure in your tackle box.
Yeah. Brandon, pick something out of Jacob's tackle box. It'll be fine. He'll send you a high-res image.
That's a fantastic. Think about that for a minute. Just visualize. A bell curve is the backside of a cylinder. It's beautiful.
That's strong.
That's all right.
And lastly, we have old-timers' feelings are hurt more by live scope than the fishery.
Oh, you know, don't let Denny fool you. If live scope were a thing back when he was still on tour, Denny would learn live scope. He certainly won a lot of money with a flipping stick in his hand and a black and blue jig or a tube, but he also won tournaments on spinnerbaits and crankbaits and other stuff. That's how you win 18 BASS events in your career. That's how you win a BASS Angler of the Year, an FLW Angler of the Year, get on a box of Wheaties. He could do it all.
Yes, he can. Yes, he can.
They started coming after me, too.
Uh-oh.
The intern's nickname should be Fauci.
Ouch.
Ouch.
Fauci.
Ouch. Jeez. What do you think of that, Jacob? Come on.
Jeez, guys.
What are you talking about? That's an honor. He's an elite series angler, bud.
Well, are you sure? Is he more of an elite series angler?
I don't know, but I made sure I saw that, and I wrote it down in my notebook.
As potential.
I also see another Jacob submission that just came in. Jacob loved me two times, Morrison.
Oh, I like that a lot because I'm a big Doors
fan. I knew you would.
Yeah. Big Doors fan.
Yeah.
Discovered the Doors when I was in college. Because when I went to college, Apocalypse Now was a thing. And that was my introduction to the Doors. Oh, yeah.
Dexter's Lore Lab, I think it was Fauci, not Fauci. That's a whole nother level of disrespect.
And we like it. We like it.
Not our intern. Jacob, what else you got there, son?
All right, we got our own Terry Battisti. Can you murderer?
That's true. My great friend, Dr. Terry Battisti, is right. When I caught my personal best largemouth at the age of 12, this fish weighed a little over 12 pounds, and I was 12 years old and had a football game later that night. I cleaned that fish. I chopped its head off with an axe, and we ate it. An axe. I couldn't get a knife to it. I was 12. I didn't know how to do anything. Sad. Bass murderer.
I was like 14, and Beth spent the night in my mom's bathtub. And then we weighed in the next day.
Yeah. That's strong. That's smart. Mine was weighed on bathroom scales. I got on the bathroom scales and weighed, and then I got on the bathroom scales with the fish and weighed.
And what'd you say it weighed?
A little over 12.
Because you had digital scales back in the...
No. Yeah. Digital wasn't even a word.
No. I just saw another Jacob. Damn it. I lost it. Another submission.
Jacob, are you seeing any nicknames roll through that you like for yourself?
Coon murderer? No.
Nothing.
Jacob,
right,
this is audio, Jacob.
I know, sorry. All right, Sean. I'm surprised BTC isn't snacking on something.
He's always eating. Always. Yeah, he's eating. Oh my gosh, he's always got. Oh, he's got ravioli.
Yeah, it's like bow ties pasta with, and it showed up like right before we went live, and you know, it couldn't be rude.
Oh, he's got his wife bringing him food. That's just
wrong. My god, that's good.
Vicodin from a Pez dispenser.
All right, yeah, we got BTC eats Vicodin from a Pez dispenser.
I like the hashtag bad comments. Maybe we should ask everybody to put that hashtag on so you can spot them quicker.
Yes.
All right, let's just close things off with a lighter note. Jimmy wants to know, how's your recovery going, BTC?
All right, well, we're 1 week into the new shoulder. It's going to be a long road, I'm pretty sure. Last week when I was on, I had just had the surgery done that day. I was on this nerve block thing, so my arm was just dead. I couldn't feel it. And, you know, from my fingers to wherever in my neck, arm was dead. And it just slowly started working back. You know, I could feel my fingers and then elbow and bicep. So it was a Saturday morning at 5 a.m. that it hit. Or it wore, you know, the nerve block wore off and I could feel, you know, I had gotten the heads up, like, don't wait until it's wore off to start the pain medication. I don't like pain pills, you know, be honest with you. I know I got friends that died from getting strung out on this stuff. I don't like being dull like that. I'm dull enough as it is mentally. But it was a good call. I guessed right and started. And there are only 5 milligram Percocets, but that's helped. And we're a week into it. It's going to be a long one. You know, just got to get my whole arm used to a new socket and new ball and this, that, and the third. And shit still hurts, but it's not unbearable. Blah, blah, blah. Go to work, Stockel. Thank you, Paul. I agree.
That was Jimmy asked that question. And Jimmy, for what it's worth, I think it was on Sunday. Jacob, you can back me up on this. I think it was on Sunday. BTC sends us all a text saying, I don't think I'm going to make it. Man, I'm doing the show without me. And the show was still 5 days away. And he's already thinking he's not going to be in any condition to do the show. So
Yeah, it was a weak moment. Yeah, painkillers—they take you through a roller coaster of emotions.
No, you've been a tough guy through this whole thing, and I'm still amazed you did the show the same day you had the surgery. That was ridiculous.
Yes, and rightfully so, Ken. I think everyone should be amazed. It's a whale of a feat that most men here couldn't handle because they're smarter. That's why. Anthony's been a killer on the message board. Anthony777, did you buy the bidet yet, BTC? Dude, let me tell you something. Guys, you know what? I'm going to save this for dark thoughts in about 7 minutes. But I got something to weigh in on about this.
Good to see Paul.
A little men's health. Yes. Carry on.
Putting you in your place and says back to work. Jacob, great job on bad comments as always, man. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was really good stuff. I'm glad, and I'm glad the audience has jumped in and taken it in the right spirit. We need to see more, but we really enjoy that. We really want to hear from y'all.
Yes, Nathan, we're gonna take Jacob out. I don't know.
See ya.
Can't you do that left hand, right handed?
There it is. That's the best part.
That is the best part.
No, I can't.
Uh-oh. Now it's the next time you snap, I'm gone. Next time you snap, I'm gone. Oh.
No, I can't do it. Left-handed. Relax. Relax.
Come on. It's time for me to go.
I know. I know. You're too excited to leave, and that's why I'm going to make this painfully awkward. Blah, blah, blah. Questions this, that, and the third. Ken Duke out. Dude, we didn't do the top 10 yet.
No, I'm out before the top 10. Do I have to snap myself off the show? I can do that. Nathan, okay, let's go.
Just like that. No grand introduction. Ken did a marvelous job as always. It's an honor to work with him. You have no idea. Dude, let's get to it. The top 10 tackle shop pickup lines. Let's go.
The top 10 tackle shop pickup lines. Number 10, why yes, that is a Sarah spook in my pocket, but I'm also happy to see you. Number 9, you've definitely got my sonar facing forward. Number 8, what's a nice girl like you doing fishing a pattern like this? Number 7, are you Team Kevin or Team Skeet? Number 6, my toad isn't the only thing that's horny. Number 5, after I pull this big mama off her bed, I want to pull you into mine. Number 4, you're more than just a community hole to me. Number 3, hi, I'm Jacob Fouts. Hey, where are you going? Number 2, I lost my boat keys. Can I check your pants? And the number 1 tackle shop pickup line, baby, you're a custom glide in a room full of stink bait.
Outstanding. Outstanding top 10, honestly. And there was some really good ones that did not make the cut. Just couldn't get them all in there. Anyhow, guys, thank you for tuning in tonight. Thank you to our guests, Denny Brauer, Bert Deener, Steven Bardin. Awesome guys. Please, if you enjoy what you're you know, watching here, like, subscribe, tell a friend. It'd mean a lot to us. We're trying to make this thing the best thing ever, and need your help, man. Let's see what else we got. Shout out to Nathan Benson, killing it as the producer. Our intern, young Jacob Morrison. Again, keep the names coming. One of them's going to stick. It's going to be amazing. I know you guys got it in you. Shout out to James Rylee for the dopest logo. Hats coming soon. Hats and stickers. Ron Stallings for that intro. Next week, next Thursday, February 15th. Dude, this is going to be a big one. Does scent matter? Now, if you believe in what we do, you know we're going to do our best to get the broadest, most honest look at this topic. And we have two super key guests lined up. The scientists are tough to get on board. You know, apparently scientists are super busy. But we've got them, man. We've got the guys that have created and invented, and it's going to be an amazing show. It's a big one. Next week, does scent matter? And now, that's a wrap. And let's take us to Dark Thoughts with BTC. I don't know if Nathan had a fucking intro for me since Jake got one, but apparently not. So we'll just wing it here. And we'll work on that intro later, Nate. Dudes, bidet. Let me tell you something. If you guys don't know, fucking bidet is amazing. Speaking of scent mattering, bidet's got your back. I installed one probably 6-7 years ago, maybe a little more. Figured, let me try this thing out. We'll see what all the buzz is about. Amazing. We're doing it wrong in the United States of America. We do a lot of stuff right. We're doing that wrong. Dragging that dry ass paper on your sore spot, your soft spot. It's not the way. Bidets are amazing. You can get a bidet seat off of Amazon for a couple $100. Put it on your standard toilet. You know, you got to dial in, you know, elongated bowl, round bowl, whatever. The only key is you got to get an outlet near your toilet, right? But now you have a heated seat. You have warm water, cleans you, dries you. Don't get one that doesn't have the blow dry thing, because, you know, I got a cheap ass buddy that bought one that wets your ass and then doesn't dry it, and then you use paper on water. It just doesn't work. It's a mess. He's a mess. Jesse McGee, everybody, give him a follow. But yeah, bidets, man, shit. Get out there, guys. Thanks for watching. See you next week.